السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، وبه نستعين، ونصلي ونسلم على أفضل الخلق أجمعين، نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه والتابعين ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين وبعد. We praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, send blessings and salutations upon Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his entire household, all his companions, and all those who struggled and strove through the years to bring this deen to us in a way that today we are seated here. And we ask Allah to use us to do the same, so that our offspring can be on the deen, and so that we can be from amongst those who achieve success on the Day of Judgment. Ameen. Brothers and sisters in Islam, we all know that shaitan is a great enemy, and we all know that he stands in our way in order to divert us from doing what we are supposed to be doing. So there is a path, there is a road that we are supposed to be treading upon, there is a system that we are supposed to be operating upon, and yet shaitan stands in our way trying to divert us in order for us to achieve, instead of the pleasure of Allah, the anger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And it's very important for us to realize that Allah, through His mercy, Rabbul Izzati wal Jalal, what He has done for us as a favor is He has told us exactly how shaitan comes. So to be able to recognize him, that's Allah's gift upon us. He tells us he will come this way, he will try that way, he will try his tricks in this way, and you need to recognize him. Just like today, in a country like South Africa where crime is quite high, it would be a gift upon us if people told us that, be careful, the robbers are using new tricks, this is what they are doing, and that is what they are doing. We would say, Jazakallah khair, thank you for letting me know. They tell you, don't use that ATM machine, be careful, there are people operating in this way, don't go to that place, watch your back when people are following you, if they are, this is what you should do. This is what we listen to. People tell you, if someone is following you, drive to the nearest police station. And people will tell you so many things. Sometimes it might not come handy to all of us, but at least we will be on the lookout. People say they push your bell at your gate and they tell you they've come to read the water meter. Next thing, they're inside with their guns and so on. We get so happy when people tell us, when they support us, when they help us to fight crime. We are very excited, mashallah, we thank them. Why don't we thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for showing us how the biggest criminal, who is shaitan, comes not only to take our wealth away or to harm us physically, but to take the essence of our entire existence away, and that is our struggle to achieve paradise. So let's today look at a few pointers how shaitan comes to us. Firstly, first and foremost, shaitan comes in some very blatant ways. Sometimes he comes and he immediately invites you to that which is haram, and a person would get involved, he beautifies it by saying, don't worry, it's just once, it's just now, I will make tawbah later on. That's sometimes shaitan comes to us that way. Today we don't want to talk about this direct way, because that we're supposed to be knowing already. For someone to say, let me commit this adultery now, and inshallah as soon as I'm over, I will engage in tawbah, that is defying Allah. That is the height of defiance, to say, I will sin against you, and after a while I'll say, I'm sorry. A'udhu billah. If someone does it to me and you, saying, look, I'll harm this uncle, or I will do this to this sister, and after that I'll just say, I'm sorry, and get away with it, it's a very, very big insult. So we don't want to go too deep into that. But let us take a look at the disguised ways that shaitan comes to good Muslims. Did you hear what I just said? The disguised ways that shaitan comes to good Muslims, those who read their salah, those who perhaps are conscious of halal and haram, shaitan comes to us as well. Shaitan comes to those who try to be good, and shaitan comes even to the best of the best from amongst us. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us identify him and help us realize how we are supposed to be tackling him, and grant us acceptance to tackle him. Point number one is, he comes to us and makes us delay. D-E-L-A-Y. Delay a deed that you are supposed to be doing. So, for example, it's time for Salah, and Shaitan says, I'll do it just now. That word just now is one of the traps of the devil. When you say, I'll do it just now, or I'll turn just now, or you want to give up a bad habit, and you tell yourself, I'm still a bit young, inshallah, I'll do it as I grow a little bit older. That is Shaitan's plot. It is his plan. It's his grip. And he's so happy and excited. Wow, I got this man exactly where I wanted him to. I've made him delay his salah. So as the time for salah progresses, Shaitan then comes through with forgetfulness. وَمَا أَنْسَانِيهُ إِلَّا الشَّيْطَانُ أَنْ أَذْكُرَهُ. The story of Musa alayhi salam in Surah Al-Kahf, when the young boy says, it was Shaitan who made me forget. Shaitan made me forget. So the good things, Shaitan makes you forget. The turning to Allah, Shaitan makes you forget. So once Shaitan has delayed you after you had something in mind, or after you wanted to do a good deed or abstain from a bad deed, when he delays you, his next step is to make you forget, oblivious. So now you've forgotten. Before you know it, oh no, the time of Asr is over. Wallahi, it happens to even good people, where you want to read your salah, you're about to read it, something happens, someone rings the bell, instead of opening the door and saying, brother, please have a seat, let me finish my salah. We're too embarrassed to say, I was not in the masjid for salah. So we just say, yes brother, how are you, what's happening, what's going? And in your mind you say, I'll read my salah as soon as he goes. The adhan of Maghrib is said, and yet your salah is not read. So this is a way that Shaitan actually traps you. The solution of this is, as soon as you want to do a good deed, do it. Especially when it comes to salah. The hadith speaks of how the best salah is that salah which is read as soon as the time sets in. As-salatu ala waqtiha. Salah on its prescribed time. Once it enters, you need to be worried about not having read it until you've read it. So when the time of salah comes in, how many of us would feel very uneasy if we haven't read salah? Let's try and get ourselves onto that level by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And I really plead with myself and yourselves to try our best to get to that stage where the time of salah comes, you must feel uneasy, feel very uneasy until you've got it done. No matter where you are, inshallah, it will be possible to fulfill that particular salah. As we say, where there is a will, there is a way, by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Point number two, Shaitan comes to us and he makes us forget the path by pointing at others. This is one of the biggest ways Shaitan tackles those who are supposedly pious, those who are trying their best to please Allah. When Shaitan sees that I try to delay this man in his salah, but he's regular, he's here first saf, second saf. He's here on time. He reads a lot of Quran. He fasts. He gives a lot of charity. He does this. He does quite a lot of good deeds. The next best thing to do is occupy him by pointing at others. Allahu Akbar. This is extremely dangerous. So a person will say, look at this man. What is he doing? He's committing adultery, or he is engaged in drinking. By saying that, we have forgotten about what we are supposed to be doing, number one. Number two is, we have forgotten that we are supposed to be helping such people rather than think bad and start spreading tales. And when we spread tale, what Shaitan did, he stole even the good deeds that we were doing. Because by backbiting about someone, you're giving away your good deeds. We all know that. By backbiting about someone, you are wasting your deeds. So what Shaitan did is, you were a very good man. You read your salah. And when you read your salah, he did not know how to divert you because you were so punctual. So he said the best way is let him involve in the lives of others. He'll lose his deeds and soon he'll lose focus completely. So what happens? People start worrying. Pistorius' bail appeal is at 12:30. I wonder if he got it or not. I hope he stays in jail. He's a murderer. And I hope this. And the man worried to the degree that it's as though it's his life. And it's as though that's the main aim. I need to follow this thing here. Every one of us knows the detail of what happened. And we all have our own riwaya of the story. Each one has his own narration to say, this is what he did. Perhaps he did this. Perhaps he saw an SMS from someone else. And then he picked up his gun and went to the toilet and shot her. Whatever happened, this is a hot story in the hearts of people and minds. But have you thought, that man may be jailed or may not be jailed. We are doing deeds that may result in eternal jail. Have we ever thought of that? And sometimes we've forgotten our salah is not in order. We are criminals who are not supposed to even be deserving the bail we have right now in the world. And we worried about someone else getting bail. Allahu Akbar. This is Allah. He has a gift. He has given us a gift to say, worry about yourself. And on the other hand, there is shaitan saying, no, no, no. You sit and watch the news more than you've ever read the book of Allah. So we sit in front of the screen. We'll repeat the news every hour. We're updating to know what happened. A guy who's not a Muslim, number one. And number two, even if he was, whatever he did, he will pay for it at some stage. But what did we do? Allahu Akbar. We forget about it. I have not even read the Quran and I'm busy with the news. I flick, I'm flashing, I'm tweeting, I'm this thing. About what? About something that's not going to benefit me at all. Wallahi, this happens to almost all of us sometimes. We need to quickly pick up shaitan and realize this is his plot and throw him out of the picture. And then we go back to the Quran, the word of Allah. We should read the Quran more than we read the newspapers and the news. We should pick the pages of the Quran more than we refresh our pages on Twitter and Facebook and WhatsApp and so on, and the BlackBerry messengers. Today, subhanallah, it has got to a degree where the tools of da'wah have shifted to the degree that the da'is are beginning to use the internet to get a message across to the masses solely because that's the best way to communicate with them. If I were to ask you, what's the best way to communicate with you? Some people might say, well, phone me on my landline. That person still probably was born before 1960. May Allah grant us all goodness. And then if they tell you, listen brother, you know what, you can phone me on my mobile phone. Okay, a little bit more modern. If someone says, WhatsApp me, oh, that's now 1975, 80 and later. Alhamdulillah. And then if they tell you, you can BBM me. Oh, that's also quite jacked, you know. And after that, they say, no, I'll see your tweet. Oh, if that's the case, that means it's the new generation you're talking about. And someone says, I got Facebook instant messenger. It will come straight to my phone. Beep, beep, it beeps. So now when you want to remind someone of salah, those who have a bit of sense will say, let's get to the pocket of this person by beeping him straight. Send out a BBM broadcast, send out something, you know, inspirational, reminding them of salah and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because we become diverted by technology, yet technology is not bad on its own. It's how we use it that makes it bad. We can use technology to become the best of people. Remind yourselves. There is another problem we have. Sometimes we see, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala safeguard our brothers and sisters in Syria, and those in Palestine, those in Afghanistan, those in Bangladesh, those in Burma, those in Sri Lanka, those across the globe, in nearly every country, those in Europe, those in the Americas, those in Australia, those in Mali, you name them, the names are increasing every day. Our brothers and sisters are suffering and suffocating. So people say, what are the Arabs doing about those people? Shame on them. Brother, that is a plot of the devil. You worry, what are you doing about them? What did you do? You busy in the nightclub worrying about what the Arabs did about Syria. They probably gave their lives without you knowing. Because the people who really do things, they don't have to advertise. Allahu Akbar. They probably are there on the ground already and you're just busy saying, what are they doing? These people are quiet, they are silent, they haven't done anything. The reality is you need to worry about what you are doing, because the difference will only be made when you start doing something and I think the same and everybody else around there thinks the same, then the difference is made. Subhanallah. But the minute I think, what is he doing? He thinks, what am I doing? Has anyone done anything? The reality is no, we're busy sitting and pointing fingers. I'm worried more about what did he do than what did I do. Because I am not able to govern his life, but I definitely can use my 2 feet to get up and I can put my hand in my pocket and I can donate a thing or two and I can raise my hands and make a dua to Allah and perhaps I can assist by going out as a volunteer and helping in whatever way is in my capacity. So if each one of us was concerned really, what is my capacity? What have I done? How many rands or dollars or pounds have I put into the coffers of those who are going genuinely to assist? Subhanallah. Then we would be speaking. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala open our doors. Really, we make a dua for our brothers and sisters at this blessed moment of Jumu'ah, this beautiful hour. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to assist all those suffering across the globe, to use us to help them in one way or another. And I repeat again, may Allah use us to help them in one way or another. And may Allah help us the day we are in need. My brothers and sisters, the plot of shaitan is very, very strong. And he is intelligent. The more intelligent you become, the more intelligent the methods of the devil become to try and plot and plan. So what happens? The devil comes and make us point fingers. I've given you a current example. It's live. If you pick up any youngster, or in fact a lot of the adults as well, and ask him, what's going on with this case here? They'll give you up-to-date information. Last thing was 12:30. They were supposed to talk. Some of you might already know the result of the bail. Allahu Akbar. May Allah protect us. While we're sitting here, we have tweets going on, we have this going on. This is shaitan making us lose focus. Nobody is saying you're not allowed to know about it. You can learn a lesson from it. May Allah protect us. You can learn many lessons from the story. But the reality is, are you engrossed in it in a way that your life has a certain focus that it's supposed to have been on, and now it's focusing on something less important? Like, you know, if there was a pot and we were told to put in rocks, stones and sand, you would start off first by putting the rocks, the most important, the big. If you put the sand first, there will be no place to put the rocks. But if you put the rocks, the stones will find their way in the gaps that were created by the rocks. You shake that pot a little bit, then you put the sand in, and mashallah, it may cover everything, but at the same time it will find its way to the bottom in the gaps and so on. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us understand that. Shaitan's plan. What is it? Worry about him. What did he do? Look at these people. That man's a drunkard. Brother, in your own backyard, in your own family, there is worse. Allahu Akbar. And this sometimes is a punishment for us to realize, why are you spreading rumor about the children of other people without looking at your own children? It's a problem. Your concern is your children and your family members, and even the ummah is your concern in a positive way. Try to help properly. But was your concern to spread rumor about others? If that's the case, wallahi, we've lost the plot. And this is why we have reminders of this nature. This is why the Quran and the Sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, full of reminders. Look, watch out, the devil comes to you like this. Recognize him. Inna ash-shaytana lakum aduwwun fattakhidhuhu aduwwa. Indeed, shaytan is your enemy. So consider him an outright enemy. Don't pat him on the back. You know, don't try and make friends with him. No, you need to realize, let me recognize the devil. How does he come to me? May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us protection, and may he make us from those who understand and realize. Let's move on to another point. When shaitan entraps, he makes something very serious appear to be light in the eyes of people. So sometimes there is a heinous crime, and shaitan says, no, don't worry, this is something minor, man. It's something small. I can give you an example. In Surah An-Nur, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks of how the hypocrites had created a story against Aisha radiallahu anha. And they started spreading it. And some of them were not actually hypocrites, but they engaged in a sin by spreading the rumor alone. They did not create it, but they just said, hey, did you hear the story? By saying, did you hear the story, Allah says in the Quran, وَتَحْسَبُونَهُ هَيِّنًا وَهُوَ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ عَظِيمٌ. You think it's something light in the eyes of Allah. It is something huge. It is something great. It is a huge sin. So this is the plot of the devil. We spread a rumor. Hey, did you hear what happened to that woman there? Did you check what happened to this man? You saw this, that. Allah says, you think it's light that you're just talking about this in this way here. In the eyes of Allah, you're going to pay for it. You are going to pay for it. Allahu Akbar. What you do, you will have to undo. Remember that. What you do, you will have to undo. Two ways of undoing it. Either the good way through tawbah and repentance, or the bad way, leave it as is, and Allah will sort you out. Allahu Akbar. That is quite harsh, which means it is quite a serious reality. If someone tells you Allah will sort you out, wallahi, that's a very big statement. So we'd rather sort it out through tawbah, here and now. May Allah forgive our shortcomings. Brothers and sisters, we may have said things, we may have done things, we may have been diverted, we may have given preference to, you know, the newspapers over the Quran. And wallahi, this is a fact. We read the newspapers or the news sometimes more than we've actually read the Quran that day. Ask yourself. See, look into yourself honestly. It's a fact. Sometimes we have lost the path because we have considered major things minor. And sometimes we've lost the path because we've interfered in the lives of others. Wallahi, my brothers and sisters, it's never too late. For as long as we are breathing and we are still within the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we engage in tawbah and say, Ya Allah, guide us. Help us so that yes, we can give everything its due measure. We can learn lessons from what's going on around us. And at the same time, we can be used for that which we are supposed to be used for, in a way that we live our lives with two things. One is, you fulfill the rights of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and two, you fulfill the rights of the fellow creatures of yours, human beings, and even the other creatures of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us goodness. May He open our doors. Remember, every week we have what is known as Jumu'ah. That is a gift of Allah upon us, the most blessed day of the week. We know that. We need to ask ourselves, how many of us would consider it such a blessed day that we come to the masjid, the house of Allah, very early, and we can sit, read our Quran, engage in a bit of adhkar, and perhaps listen to a talk. No matter who is giving a talk, listen to a few words. You will take back something beneficial. You will take back something beneficial. But if you are here early every week and you make it your business to be proud of the fact that you've been given a blessed day of the week, wallahi, you will notice a change in your spirituality. You will notice a change. Why? Because this is one of the sanctuaries of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The respected days of the week, or the respected day of the week, more than others, higher than others. So if you have the respect for the Friday, not to say you're allowed to sin on other days, no. But on this day we want to engage in more obedience. That's the idea. We want to engage in more obedience. We want to come early. We've been given opportunity. Let us seize the opportunities. When we understand this, we will definitely be able to impact on ourselves positively. Because how many of us have a positive message that gets to us on a regular basis? Many of us, the only connection we have is a Friday, Jumu'ah. And that too, we're busy rushing into the masjid, making it in time for the second adhan, and we're hoping that, hey, at least I caught the salah. Soon as the salah is over, we're the first ones out. Is that how we treat our deen? When Allah has kept a Friday, more so to get a powerful message, to understand how to lead your life, and to continue for the rest of the week, in a way that when you get back, you're ready for another solid message, like a dose of cough mixture for a one who is suffering from a cough. So you have your 5 months this week, come back next week, you get another 5 months. And if you have a boost in the middle, where you have a lesson or a talk or some form of a lecture or some form of benefit, no matter how it gets to you, then alhamdulillah, that is nurun ala nur. That is even better. But a lot of us are busy working. We work from the morning to the evening. We have not benefited from the radio station. Sometimes we have not benefited from CDs and DVDs and what else you have. We've benefited in no way sometimes because we're so busy. And then what happens? The only link, or when we come home, we're busy with the flicking the television, watching the news and checking this and that. And some of us are busy following our soaps. Yet that is the only soap that makes you dirty. Have you thought of that? The only soap that makes you dirty are the soaps you find on the TV. The other soap can wash you and clean you. This, I don't even know why they call it a soap. Perhaps they are washing your brain. Brainwashing. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. And we're sitting, flicking and so on. Time for salah goes, we're busy. You know, we haven't even given time to our family members, let alone Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the only link we have is a Friday. If that is the case, come on, we can do better. We need to understand the plot of shaitan. He makes us live this dunya as though we are never ever going to the akhirah. The best way to recognize the devil, the best way to recognize the devil, is to be conscious of death and to understand it can overtake you here and now. If you are really conscious of that, it comes with the consciousness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And it comes with the ability to prepare. And therefore, you will not delay a good deed. Look at Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He tells us beautifully, Salli salata muwadda'in. Fulfill your salah as though it is a farewell salah. Do we do that? How beautifully worded it is. Farewell salah. This is my farewell salah. I'm reading it, the end, it's on, it's over. It's the last salah I'm going to have an opportunity to read. Wallahi, my brothers and sisters, ask yourself in your own hearts, how many of us actually do that? How many of us actually do that? That this is my last salah. And when you finish it, you thank Allah, Ya Allah, you're going to give me an opportunity to read another one perhaps. Allahu Akbar. And when you come again, you know, Subhanallah. You know, I deal a lot with the youth, and sometimes we talk to them and we know what is close to their hearts. And sometimes you tell them, what's the best thing you can have? He says, hey, that girlfriend of mine, if she walked into my house dressed up so sweet and smart, ooh, I would be the happiest man on earth. This is an answer you actually get. And then you ask him, when did you last see her? Oh, this morning. So you're so excited, you wouldn't mind seeing her again and again. Okay, let's stop there. If Allah had to take you away here and now, Subhanallah, why is it that we wouldn't be so excited to have had another opportunity to show Allah that we love Him and we're worshipping Him? After all, He gave us the entire existence that we have here right now. The eyes and the nose and the ears and the brains and the looks and the everything you have. He is the one who gave me the wealth and the children and the everything else. And yet we are not excited about fulfilling the salah for Him. Perhaps if we were, He might have made that haram relation halal if we were conscious of Him. Because He would have used us to understand, hey, I cannot continue in this way. Let me turn to Allah. Let me go to the parents of so and so. Make a proper proposal. Get this thing done. Not have a long engagement or anything. Once it's confirmed, we get a nikah done. And we are in the obedience of Allah. If you die 5 minutes later, perhaps you will be granted entry into paradise. Because your intention was to please Allah. But shaitan makes us lose focus. No.
كَلَّا بَلْ تُحِبُّونَ الْعَاجِلَةَ وَتَذَرُونَ الْآخِرَةَ
Nay, Allahu Akbar. You love that which is right in front of you, the dunya. And you're forgetting about the akhirah. In fact, in Surah Al-A'la, which we read on a Friday, we hear the verses Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about them so clearly. Where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says,
بَلْ تُؤْثِرُونَ الْحَيَاةَ الدُّنْيَا والآخرة خير وأبقى.
We've heard it so many times. Do you know what it means? It means, man, you give preference to the dunya and you don't realize the akhirah is better and that is everlasting. And every Jumu'ah or every other Jumu'ah, we hear these verses. But for us, hey, this man can read. Hey, powerful reciter. That's shaitan making us think something that is true. He is a powerful reciter, but he makes us put a full stop after that. That's where it stops. So say he's a powerful reciter, the meaning of it is this, and I'm going to put it into practice because it was recited and so and so and so. Subhanallah. This is the way we will move forward, inshallah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us people who recognize what the devil is all about. And may He make us understand and realize we have something to concentrate upon. That is my link with Allah. And inshallah, we will all be granted entry into paradise. May Allah grant us Jannah. Wa sallallahu wa sallam wa baraka ala nabina Muhammad.